Good morning. Grace and peace be to each of you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And a special welcome today for all those extended family members of our beloved saints whom we celebrate and remember today. As we begin, a few reminders for those of this congregation and those of our charge. We'll have charge conference next Sunday afternoon at 2:30. So make sure to mark your calendars for that. This week, we celebrate the saints in All Saints Remembrance. The family of Charles and Lucy Little have catered a meal on behalf of all the saints and invite you to stay afterward in the fellowship hall upstairs as we celebrate their loved ones and all of our loved ones of this congregation. So come for a time of remembrance and sharing and feasting in remembrance with the communion of saints. One of those people that we remember and celebrate is Sandy Bruni's son, Rob Stewart. Next Saturday on the 13th at 11 o'clock, we'll celebrate his life here in the sanctuary. But here now, dear friends, we are God's beloved children. God loves us so dearly, no matter where we are in our grief, whether it is fresh or seasoned, God is with us to meet with us in worship. So as you are able, I invite you to stand as we join together in our call to worship.
Join in the call to worship today. Let us praise the God of our ancestors, who robs death of its sting and the grave of its victory. Let us praise the God of our ancestors, who fills life with its joy and the future with its hope. Come, let us worship the Lord our God, the same as we have today and forever. Please remain standing for the first hymn, which is hymn number 711, For All the Saints.
Thank you.
Our reading today is from the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. This can be found in your pew Bible on page 605. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. He will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from the earth. For the Lord has spoken. He said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation.
Good morning, everyone. So good to see each of you this morning. I've got a question for you. Where do you normally see a halo? In heaven. Where else? On an angel. Yep. Have you ever seen an old picture drawn of somebody who was a Christian a long time ago and they have a little halo around their head? That halo means holy, holy. And when we pray the Lord's Prayer every week, we say, Lord, hallowed be thy name. That word hallow comes from the same word as holy. So we're praying God's name be holy, and may we... That's right, that's right. It is. And we pray that we can be holy like God is holy. God invites us to do that. One of the signs of that is a halo, a halo. Now, sometimes we think that's only reserved for those people who have died and gone on to be with Jesus in heaven, but God calls us all saints when we follow God. So sometimes we mess up, sometimes we don't do what mom and dad ask, sometimes we get frustrated at school and things don't go our way, but God's invitation to us is to be holy like God is holy. So I've got a reminder for you, a halo for you to wear. You don't have to keep it on long, but you can wear it all the way through the service. Here's one for you too, Mom. We're all, because we follow God, we're invited to be holy, and we can be called saints too. So with all the angels and all the saints who've gone before us. How about you put it on your head? Ah, there you go. Let us pray. God, you are holy. Hallowed be your name. Help each of us to be holy as you are holy, to love you as you have loved us, and to share that love with the whole world, just like all the saints and angels before us. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Thanks. You can go back to your seats. Our gospel lesson comes to us from John in the 11th chapter, verses 32 through 44. Listen with me for God's word. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, there's already a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations upon each of our hearts be holy and acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When my older sister Sarah was in sixth grade, she was part of a play at school called A Thousand Cranes. Everyone in the cast was tasked with helping to fold a thousand cranes so they could have it as part of the set. And they needed friends and family to help with that too. So it was then that I learned to fold cranes and helped her. And from then on, I folded cranes to keep my hands busy while I'm listening. I folded cranes a bunch in school. I'd tear up a piece of paper into little bits and fold little tiny cranes too. These are just a few of all of them that I have left. There's a Japanese legend that anyone folding a thousand cranes is granted a wish. And cranes are associated with things like health and longevity and peace. So if you were to fold a thousand cranes with these attributes in mind, your wish would be granted. That play, A Thousand Cranes, is a true story of Sadako Sasaki, a Japanese girl who was 2 years old when the atomic bomb was dropped just a mile from her home on August 6, 1945. When she was 12, she developed leukemia, and she set out to fold cranes, a thousand cranes, for a wish of health and longevity. At the time of her death, she had folded 644 when she died in 1955. Our first response to tragedy is often the question, why? Why? Why me? Why my loved one? But if we can pause on that question just for a little while, another one comes up. And that is, where? Where? Where is God in the midst of suffering? And that's a question we can answer. Scripture tells us that Jesus is our image of God. So if we want to know what God looks like, how God acts, well, we've got the stories of Scripture to tell us where Jesus is in the midst of suffering. And where do we find Jesus in the midst of suffering, death, and grief? Well, look at him at the grave of his friend Lazarus, weeping. Jesus has good friends in Bethany, these sisters and brothers, Lazarus and their sisters, Mary and Martha. Jesus loves Mary and Martha, and Lazarus clearly has spent a lot of time in their home being welcomed by them, loves them dearly. Lazarus has died just before this narrative picks up, and Mary and Martha have sent for Jesus knowing how much Lazarus means to him, and he's a few days away and finally comes to join them. And they're anxiously asking themselves after their brother has died, where is Jesus? He should be here. They believe in his power to bring life and health and peace. But Jesus is late. He seems too late. Both sisters have said to him, one before this section of scripture began, one during this passage, if only you had been here, Lord. If only you had been here, my brother would not have died. They're heartbroken and disappointed, and Jesus is heartbroken and disappointed. And even those all around, not part of the family, are looking at Jesus saying things like, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man from dying? They see only Jesus' power to prevent, not his power to overturn the situation. Jesus has said to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. But this promise seems inconceivable to her in the midst of grief and death, and she can't quite wrap her mind and her heart around it. And Sister Mary falls at the feet of Jesus saying, again, if only, Lord. You see, in the Jewish tradition, a soul remains around the body for 3 days, but then on the fourth, they're separated. And so there's hope for the first 3 days after death, and on the fourth day, that is gone. Lazarus has been dead 4 days. He is deader than dead. He is gone. In the midst of our grief, in the midst of Mary and Martha's grief, Jesus, thankfully, blessedly, does not rebuke them for their lack of faith. He does not give them pat answers. He does not try to explain away their situation and their pain. He weeps with them, and he weeps for us. He weeps in grief for hope diminished. He weeps because he loves Lazarus. He weeps in anger and defiance of death's hold on us. And Jesus takes our sorrow seriously, maybe even more seriously than we take it. He will never forget how hard we have cried. He'll never forget how deep our pain. And he has bound himself with a promise to wipe every tear from our eyes. And it's a wonder that God weeps with us. God chooses to enter suffering with us. And in any situation of pain and suffering, I believe God is the first to weep and to cry out. You see, when we want to know where God is in the midst of suffering, we can look at Jesus on the cross, where God says an ultimate no to suffering and death and pain. God chooses to be known in isolation and pain and grief in brokenness. Suffering itself is not redemptive, but God's tears and actions are in the midst of it, and God will get us through it. In John chapter 10, we learn that Jesus is the good shepherd, the one who calls his sheep by name and will lay down his life for those sheep, for us. And Lazarus here is a sheep, of Jesus. He knows his voice so well. And so even when deader than dead, Jesus tells them, roll away the stone, and calls out for Lazarus. I love in the King James Version Martha's objection to Jesus, but Lord, he stinketh. It's too late, Jesus. Just let it be, let it go. I'm disappointed you didn't get here on time, but it's done. There's too much of a disruption here. Just let me be in my grief. But Jesus cries, Lazarus, come out, come out. This is the abundant grace we all have access to. Even if we are deader than dead, we can still hear the one who calls out our name. And Lazarus comes out in grave clothes. He is stumbling and surrounded and bound with death. Perhaps you too are in this situation, struggling with grief and pain that wraps you up, tangles you up. Maybe you're tangled with that big why question too. Thankfully, Jesus doesn't urge us to move through death too quickly. He doesn't ask us to run while we're still bound with all of these things. He'll walk with us at the pace we need. But Lazarus can't get out of those grave clothes by himself, and we can't either. Jesus tells all those gathered around, unbind him, unbind him. Through our relationships, our work, our roles with one another, Jesus is still commanding us to help unbind one another, to release us, to renew us for abundant life. We are called to participate in his miracle of new life and renewal. I wonder how many times someone is released from a dead end, released from death, and we refuse to participate, letting them back into community or helping them to take those grave clothes off. Sadako Sasaki folded 644 cranes at the time of her death, and the story is that her friends and family folded the remaining cranes to complete 1,000 to put in her casket with her. You and I need the community to get to resurrected life. We can't get to the fullness of that by ourselves. One of the things that my husband Kevin and I love about living in Anson County is the PD Wildlife Reserve, just a few minutes down the road from here. It is a place of glory and beauty and peace, and you can walk or you can drive around and access that. But the thing we love the most is going about an hour before sunset around that main drive. Around the lake, the road goes all the way around, and if you go just before sunset, there are all these great egrets that come from all directions, and they come settle in the trees that are in the middle of the lake. They come with grace and royalty and beauty and peace, and they just settle in all together, that great community, just before the sunset. All around the sanctuary, you'll find cranes at the end of your pews, some up in front here. And this morning, I invite you to think of these cranes like those egrets coming in from all directions to settle. To invite us to think of these as our saints who have departed us, the ones who encircle us in the community of saints, who are rooting us on, who bring us health and longevity, well-being, and peace. In fact, you're welcome to write on the wings of the cranes around you those you have loved and lost and gone on before you. We'll soon remember with candles those who have died in the past year, but maybe there's another saint you want to remember. There are pencils in the pews, and there's some pens up here in the front if you need them. We can honor and celebrate the saints and bring to our remembrance the peace that they bring to us. Maybe you want to write Charles and Lucy Little. Maybe you want to write someone who taught you Sunday school or formed you in the faith, someone you have loved and lost, and be reminded of the peace they have brought to your life. On All Saints, it's a special holy day where we remember all those we have loved and had to let go. But we remember that they're part of the communion of saints. They still surround us and cheer us on. And if you slow down and think about what makes them saints, it's not a big heroic action. It's those small, simple human things that have made them so dear to us. The meals we have shared together, playing games together as a family, the way they made every stitch of clothing for us, the way they played with us and got down on our level and looked us in the eye, the way they wiped that tear rolling down your cheek, or they wept in love with us. Saints are real people who live in the face of death before the God who raised Jesus from the dead, and they realize with the witness of Romans 8, neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And because of that, they can dare everything for this truth. And they can really be present with us in each and every moment of life. They're the ones that help us when we're struggling and bound with death and grief and suffering like Jesus. They help take off those grave clothes of ours so that we can live fully and abundantly in this life the way they have shown us. If you look in the Gospel of John and you flip it over to the next chapter, you'll see Lazarus in the next scene. He's been unbound, he's been refreshed, he's been renewed, and he throws a dinner party. Because that's the way to celebrate life, just as in a little while we'll feast together upstairs in the fellowship hall. This is what abundant life looks like, feasting together. And we feast together in the meal of Holy Communion. Every time we do, we can imagine those saints around us like the cranes in the sanctuary, surrounding us, lounging near to us like Lazarus lounges near to Jesus. And we join in their worship of God that is eternal and holy in the heavens. So we're invited to take and eat and drink. The good news of the gospel is this, that united in Jesus' death by his grace, you may wake from the death that is life without Jesus and live unbound now and eternally to God's glory forever and ever. Amen. Now we invite our acolytes to come up as we come to a time of remembering and naming the saints that have gone on in this past year. As I read names, if this is somebody who has especially touched your life, like somebody you may have written on a crane, you're invited to stand in honor and remembrance of their name. Fred Ross Marsh. Betty Joe Hodgett Summers. Kennedy Ray Bowers. Doris Maddox Bias. Ruby Cobble Rory. Harry Edward Reinhardt. William Carroll Bias. Carrie Jackson Rembus. George E. Matthews. Laura Talent Pratt. Robert Frank Stewart. Benjamin Clifton Brazington, Jr. Elizabeth Bain Cameron. Dorothy Capel Huntley. Elwood Taft Green, Jr. And friends, we have one more saint to add to the litany here. Lonnie Bauckham passed into the company of the saints yesterday evening. Let us now join together in a prayer for our faithful, as printed in your bulletin. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. Give to your whole church in paradise and on earth your light and your peace. Help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with the saints into the joy of your home. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Jesus Christ has taught the saints how to be good and holy, to give of themselves and their hearts, and we are invited to do the same here and now.
Thank you.
You're invited to turn to page 12 in your hymnals as we join together in the great thanksgiving. Christ our Lord invites to this his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, Miriam and Moses, Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and martyrs, God of our mothers and our fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his death, suffering, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, lifted it to heaven, gave thanks to you, and said to his disciples, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of grape and grain. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all your saints, especially those whom we've named before you. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray as Jesus teaches us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. In this world, we experience brokenness, pain, suffering, and isolation, and we struggle with it. We are bound with it. But Jesus releases us and restores us to community together. And he pours out the cup of grace and salvation to meet every need, weeping with us and rejoicing with us until we are united with the saints. This is Christ's table. All who love him, all who desire to be in union with him are invited to come. When you come forward, you'll pick up a cup of bread and juice, and you're invited to take those back to your seat with you to commune there. If you'd like, you can bring up the crane that you've written a saint's name on and place it around the altar around the front, or you can hold on to it and take it home with you, your choice. But the altar is always open for prayer and remembrance and thanksgiving. The table is prepared. Please be seated. The body of Christ broken for you. Harvey, the body of Christ broken for you. Carry, the body of Christ broken for you. Charles, the body of Christ broken in great love for you. Body of Christ broken in great love for you. Jenny, the body of Christ given great love for you. Carry, the body of Christ given great love for you. Effie, the body of Christ given great love for you. Corinne, the body of Christ given great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Body of Christ given in great love for you. Thank you. Friends, Jesus invites us to unbind them. In our time, we are released from sin and death and grief and suffering and pain for life abundant, according to the witness of the saints. Go and do likewise. Amen.